morning, good afternoon, good evening, powerhouses. This is Dr. D, here to take you through another fun-filled lesson on Chapter 7, which is Module 2, Chapter 7, Long-Term Assets, with a focus on depreciation, the methods. Remember from our introductory terminology topic, I told you this would be a SAD topic. What does SAD stand for? Right, straight line, activity-based, and declining balance, the three methods. This video will focus on straight line, and we'll focus on declining balance. And declining balance, also known as double declining balance or DDB, is sometimes a challenging topic for students, but I'm going to take you through a good example and this should help you figure it out pretty quickly. So let's go ahead and know that Chapter 7, this depreciation methods, will cover learning objectives 1, 3, and 4. A quick recap, if you notice our accounting identity at the very top, assets equals liabilities plus stockholders' equity. Remember that assets are resources, which also must mean that they contain future economic benefits of the company. Notice that we've started out the course, we've discussed cash. Remember internal controls over cash. Cash is susceptible to theft, so we use bank reconciliations. We have petty cash funds. That's all from Chapter 4. Cash is very easy to report. We find it on the balance sheet, at the very top of the balance sheet, because it's the most liquid asset. Supplies reports amounts previously purchased and that are not used, and notice that it's not cash basis. Accounts receivable, we've gone through that topic in great detail, where we report our accounts receivable at net realizable value. Remember that? And that's where we subtract an estimate of the future bad debts using the allowance method. We discussed inventory, where we must report the inventory at lower of cost or market, which is driven by the conservatism principle. We can report inventory costs using multiple methods, including FIFO, LIFO, and weighted average. And this would all be examples of conservatism. Notice that all of the above assets, cash, supplies, accounts receivable, and inventory, are all short-term assets where the benefits are expected to last or be realized less than 1 year from the balance sheet date. Today's video topic is going to deal with long-term assets, where the benefits are expected to be derived greater than 1 year from the balance sheet date. And then most are going to report using what we call depreciable cost, which was a term that we calculated. Does anyone remember how to calculate depreciable cost? Also the same as depreciable base. Correct, that would be cost minus residual value. What do you need to know about long-term assets that are most important? Note that they have a service life of more than 1 year. Notice that they're used for operations, so they're an operating asset, and they're not held for resale. And there are two major types. So one is called property, plant, and equipment, also known as PP&E. They can be seen and touched. Examples would include land, land improvements, buildings, equipment, machinery, and even natural resources. The other bucket are what we call intangible assets. These lack physical substance. Think of intangible assets as patents and trademarks and copyrights and franchises and goodwill and trade names. All of these lack physical substance. Acquisitions. All long-term assets are recorded at what we call historical or original cost. So this is important. Under US GAAP, we must record all long-term assets at historical cost. Historical cost is equal to the cost of the asset plus all costs necessary to the asset and get it ready for its intended use and general purpose. Examples of these types of costs would include transportation costs to get the equipment from, let's say, Japan to the U.S. or to your manufacturing facility. The testing of the machinery before you put it into production. The installation, the setup, the related taxes, etc. All would be capitalized as part of the cost of the asset. So what does capitalized mean? Can you remember from the last short video? Yes, it means added to the balance sheet. Fantastic out there. Unnecessary costs are not included as part of the asset price. So there's a little mantra I want you to say with me right now. necessary cost, add it to the balance sheet. Or necessary cost, add. Everyone say that? Necessary cost, add. That's correct. If it's a necessary cost, we add it. That means put it on the balance sheet, and then we will depreciate it. So in all fact patterns, you need to decide if it's a necessary cost, and if it is, you'll capitalize it, which means add it to the balance sheet. Let's look at an example of a cost of equipment. Suppose you purchase a large equipment that requires a city permit for a wide load transportation, but you neglect to obtain the permit. Which costs are included in the cost of the equipment? Or what are the necessary costs? And there are the ones we'll add. Is the purchase price necessary? For sure. The 2% discount that you got on the equipment purchase? Sure, that came with the equipment purchase. The traffic fine? Well, you didn't have the city permit for wide load transportation. That's a tricky one. Is that really necessary? Well, that's correct. I heard someone say probably not necessary, and it really wouldn't be, right? Because the fact that you didn't get the permit was for this one-time situation. In almost all other occurrences, you would probably likely get the permit, so it would be a necessary cost. But the fine itself, or from not having the permit, is not, it's unnecessary, so we wouldn't capitalize that. The installation costs absolutely are necessary. Testing costs, absolutely. So if we go ahead and add these all together, we would see that they would add up to a $734,400. So in this particular instance, we would then record the cost as a debit to what? Equipment for $734,400, which would go on the balance sheet. We would take that traffic fine and we would have to expense it. And because it's not necessary, it's just a routine period expense. It's not capitalized. It's not put on the balance sheet. Only the equipment cost is capitalized. And then, of course, we have to pay it, so the cash gets credited for the combined amount. See how easy this is? This would be the same with buildings. You would include architectural fees, any necessary costs, back taxes. Okay, those types of things. And even there's negative costs that you would add or technically subtract out. And these would be things that are items that say you bought land and there was an old barn on the land and you broke the barn down and it was really valuable timber that was made up the building. If you could sell that timber in a secondary market, then the money you got from those sales proceeds would reduce your cost basis of the land. So we would call that a negative cost that you would include into a capitalized situation. So keep that in mind. Negative costs, like proceeds that you get from selling something that you got on a piece of land, like the barn example, would be a negative cost that you would add in, or it gets subtracted out, obviously. Expenditures after acquisition. So these are all the costs up to the date of acquisition. What happens when you spend money on your property, plant, and equipment, your long-term assets, after you acquire it? So over the life, the owners have to incur additional expenditures for repairs and maintenance, additions, improvements, and litigation costs. How are these expenses reported? Do we report them as an asset or as an expense? Well, we capitalize those costs, okay, as an asset if the expenditure increases the future benefits of that asset. If the expenditures only benefit the current period, then we're going to treat it as an expense and run it through the income statement. Types of expenditures after acquisition are what we call for routine maintenance, which we call repairs and maintenance, or if we add a new major component to an existing asset, which is called an addition, or if we replace a major component of an existing asset, then we'll call that an improvement. I have this little graph, if you could follow the timeline here and the little lines from expenditures. Of expenditures, they can fall into three buckets: additions, improvements, or repairs and maintenance. Additions and improvements both go in the same direction, and these would be capitalized costs that will be recorded as an expenditure as a purchased asset. The last one, repairs and maintenance, is going to be directly expensed because it doesn't provide future benefits. So we're going to directly expense it. So let's see how if we've remembered and what we've retained from this short video on capitalizing versus expensing. I'm going to ask a list of questions here. Let's see if you can decide whether to capitalize or expense it. Remember, we want it to be extraordinary. We want it to extend the future benefits. It has to be a necessary cost. And if it is all of those things, we capitalize it. If it's ordinary, or it's not necessary, or it's out of scope from the primary transaction, then it probably likely will be expensed. So let's see if we can get these right. Number one, paid for ordinary repairs. Yes, expense. Paid for extraordinary repairs. Well, that sounds kind of special. Probably want to capitalize that. Paid for an addition to an old building. An addition, that's going to be capitalized. Remember, we saw the graph. Paid for routine maintenance. You're correct out there, expense. Paid for a machine with a long-term debt. Interesting. It's going to be capitalized. It doesn't matter how you paid for it, financing the equipment. You'll just have a liability on your balance sheet, but you still have to record the cost of the asset as a capital asset. You paid for a 3-year insurance premium. Be careful here. It's 3 years. It's greater than 1 year. So does it provide future benefits? Likely yes, so it would be capitalized. If it was 1 year or less, or a 1-year policy, it would likely be just expensed. You paid for land. Land's an asset. Capitalize. Paid for monthly salaries. Monthly, current salaries. Whenever you hear the sight word current, you think expense. Very good. And you paid for cash dividends. Careful here. Remember, dividends are never, ever, ever, ever an expense. They are what? Directly closed out into retained earnings. They reduce retained earnings, but they don't affect the income statements. They're not an expense, and they don't go on the balance sheet. They're run through stockholders' equity, and they're debited and closed out into retained earnings. Remember TRED, T-R-E-D. Great job. So it's neither capitalized nor expensed. Well, I'm going to end this video right here to keep these short, but I'm going to come back and run another video for you for how we depreciate using straight line and the declining balance methods. So I hope you found this background information useful. Good luck. Keep up with your work. Doing a great job, everyone.